Far East Broadcasting Company Philippines, in partnership with Green Hills Christian Fellowship Ortigas, bring you a message from the Word of God. Together, let us know Christ and make Him known.
Good morning, beloved. A happy Sunday to each and every one of us. Today is the first Sunday of the month, and we celebrate the Lord's Supper at the end of our service this morning. We have gathered once again in spirit and in truth to worship the only triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And we praise Him because of such opportunities as this. As you may have noticed, more and more of our brethren are attending GCF on site. And truly, it is a blessing knowing that in the past 2.5 to 3 years, we have been holed up in our own homes. But now, we're experiencing more freedom, more opportunities to worship the Lord, especially here. As we worship God, allow me to read from John chapter 11. This is a conversation that the Lord Jesus Christ had with Martha, the sister of Lazarus, on the occasion of the raising of Lazarus from the dead. And Jesus said to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is to come into the world." As we worship the Lord Jesus Christ also through the commemoration of his death later, we know that God so loved us that he gave his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to come into this world so that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. This is the message of the gospel that each and every one of us ought to share to our loved ones, our coworkers, our family members. And may these truths be in our hearts as we worship God in spirit and in truth. Let's bow our heads and pray. Triune God, Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ the Son, Holy Spirit, may all that we say and do, all that we give you, offer you, through our words, our actions, may they all reflect a heart of worship. And may your name be lifted up alone through this day of worship we have. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, let's open our Bibles to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. We shall be reading from verses 18 to 24 of Hebrews chapter 12 from the English Standard Version of the Bible. Shall we all rise, beloved, as we give reverence to the reading of God's word together. From verse 18. "For you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them, for they could not endure the order that was given. If even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, 'I tremble with fear.' But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel." May the Lord bless the reading of his word. You may be seated, beloved.
Thank you, Elder Dylan. Good morning, everyone. We're so glad you've come to worship with us today. Will you please open your Bibles with me to Elder Dylan led us in reading together. That's found in Hebrews chapter 12. And for those who are joining us, especially online, I, I invited my classmates yesterday. We had a high school reunion, and everybody looks better, okay, in a high school reunion. It's just unbelievable how some look now, much better. But anyway, in case you're listening online, well, you're welcome. And we are in a series in the book of Hebrews because we want to emphasize every first Sunday of the month, which is Communion Sunday, that this is about the sacrifice, death, and ministry of Jesus Christ. That's why we are in the book of Hebrews. And I've told this before, Hebrews is really a very technical book. So if we will approach it, you know, like we were taught in seminary to do it theologically, we will not finish, even if we take a lot of time together to study this. So our approach is intentionally, without apology, devotional. So you're going to have a devotional look at Hebrews 12, 18 to 24 that we looked at today. And the whole purpose of even the sermon, not just the singing, not just the chancel choir, the whole sermon and the program itself is to point us, friends, toward the elements of the Lord's Supper that we are commemorating today. Hebrews 12, 18 to 24, where grace has brought us the case for joyful Christianity. In coal mining hundreds of years ago, they discovered that there were two gases that needed to be managed well. One of them is carbon monoxide. You know that. Your cars release that. If you have carbon monoxide inside a mine, it kills people. So they had to find a way of controlling and managing that. The other gas was methane. Methane is explosive. So either of these two can kill miners. So when they were looking for solutions in the early 1900s, they found a very low-tech but very effective solution. What was that? To detect these two dangerous gases, they discovered the use of canaries. You know what canaries are? Birds. Bright yellow birds that love to sing. Because canaries, their biological system is extremely sensitive to methane and carbon monoxide. So they would put the canaries inside the deepest parts of the mine. I know that sounds cruel, but they had a life-saving purpose. And then, when the canaries were chirping and usually singing, it means, all right, coal miners, let's go about our business. We're fine. But when the canaries fell silent, or actually fell dead, emergency, everybody out. Why did I use that? Friends, this is a picture of the Christian in this world, especially Christian joy. Christian joy is like that singing yellow canary. When you lose your joy in Christ, when you're no longer singing inside your heart, kahit pasintunado, no? Even out of tune, if you're no longer singing in your heart, there's a problem. And it's an emergency. And it could be life or spiritual life threatening. You better do something about it. That's why, friends, we said, based on how they turn off people to Christ, joyless Christians can be as bad a testimony as those who claim to be Christians and yet live immorally. Now, I'm not saying they're the same. Please. They're different. One is much more severe. But they have the same effect. If I claim to be a Christian, then people look at me and say, you know what? You look glum all the time. Now, honestly, if I now tell you, do you know if you died today and you face God, can you tell him why he will let you into this kingdom? You will not listen to me. I won't blame you because you were looking at me and my face is long, my life looks sour and glum, and you're probably asking, why should I listen to you? You're not even happy, joyful with what you've got. Why will I want what you've got? So friend, joyless Christians are dangerous to our testimony. It probably means something is wrong inside your heart. The grace that saved us, it looks weak, ineffectual, impotent when professing believers are as cranky. Have you met cranky Christians? Sometimes I am, okay? Don't ask my kids or wife, they know. But for the most part, we should not be cranky Christian or sour-faced Christians, you know? You remember the Mukasim contest? You remember that? I hope no Christian ever wins that. Because we're not supposed to look like that. But when Christians show that whether their circumstances are good or bad, they never lose hope and inner joy, guess what? What have you got? The office is closing. Look at you. You don't lose hope. What have you got? Oh, you know, in our competition, the referee seemed to be calling all the shots one way or the other, but you know, I'm never going to lose hope. And people look at you and say, what have you got? Whatever it is, if you tell me, I'll listen. That's credible Christianity because of inner joy, inner hope. By the way, it doesn't mean you go around, you know, smiling all the time, singing songs all the time, and then when you get sick, you try to pretend you're okay. That's, you know, that's called denial. That's called toxic positivity. We're not talking about that. We're talking about something inside me and you that's called the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians 5, 22 to 23, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy. It's not fake. You don't have to manufacture it. You don't have to be artificial. It comes from you. You can't help it. You can't help having peace and joy because it's a person inside you called the Holy Spirit. Friends, it makes our Christian walk what God meant it to be when we have joy. Believers grateful for past grace and hopeful in future grace, and this gives us strength for the present. This is where God's grace has brought us and what our passage is telling us. Here's the bottom line of the passage. Gratitude for past grace and hope in future grace gives us joy for the present. Gratitude for past grace and hope in future grace gives us joy for the present. A quick word of prayer. Dear Father, bless this study. The only purpose of this, Lord, is to prepare our hearts to worship you and our Lord Jesus in the communion today. Father, let it achieve that purpose, the exaltation of Christ. And if there's anyone who has never come to faith in Christ, Lord, even our worshipers online, may they come to that point of repentance and faith, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We have to admit this. The passage is strange. It's not sacrilegious for me to say that. It's a fact. I mean, just read it. It's strange, isn't it? Look at how it begins. But you have not come. What is he talking about? This author seems to be speaking in riddles. He's talking about a mountain. He's talking about two mountains here. One mountain is called Mount Sinai. The other, he already named it, is Mount Zion. But in verses 18 to 21, he's talking about Mount Sinai. And why is he doing that? You see, he is describing Mount Sinai at the time that Moses received the Ten Commandments. Have you ever seen any movie at all about the Ten Commandments? I remember Pastor BJ cracking a joke as we were together last night when he climbed Mount Sinai and he reached the top of what was supposed to be Mount Sinai. After that long, long climb, he said, so this is why Moses broke the tablets. I mean, after ascending all this way, he goes down and people are having a wild party, so he broke the tablets. People have those concepts of Mount Sinai, but here in Exodus 20, 18 to 19, there was nothing like that. It was all fearful. I'll read it for you. Exodus 20, 18 to 19, when all the people saw the thunder, the flashes of lightning, the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, the people were afraid and trembled, and they stood far off and said to Moses, you speak to us and we will listen. But do not let God speak to us lest we die. Friends, this is who you are apart from Christ. You are in Mount Sinai and the terror of the law. What do you mean, Pastor? If I have never told Jesus Christ, I am a sinner, Lord. I deserve nothing but judgment. But I turn to you as God's way of forgiveness. And I receive you as God's appointed mediator and savior that I might be forgiven. If you've never done something like that, you are figuratively in Mount Sinai. And you should be afraid. You should be very afraid. Because that's the picture here of Mount Sinai. It was God who showed himself. You know, let me use the word uncensored. He showed who he really is. That was done on purpose. It was to evoke fear in Israel because they're being given a covenant. We call that the Old Covenant. Now, may I also introduce another word besides old? I know it's a biblical word, but can I introduce the idea that the word old here means initial covenant? And we have now the new covenant in the New Testament. I'd like to call it the ultimate covenant. I'm not saying the old terms are wrong. I'm just saying these functional terms I'm proposing give you a better picture. Why do you call it the initial covenant, Pastor? Because the Ten Commandments were a conditional situation God gave to the Israelites. As a representative people, the Israelites were supposed to represent what a people who belong to God should be, believers. And you know, they did not really live up to that. But it was a conditional and a temporary covenant. Under that conditional agreement, they were supposed to follow God and God would bless them as they put their faith in the forthcoming Messiah illustrated to the sacrificial system. So friends, this is who you are apart from Christ. It is deliberately done to tell us this, our insufficiency to meet the demands of the law. What's the law? It's summarized in the Ten Commandments. Now, some of the young kids here probably, you may have memorized a lot of them. I don't know. But the law is summarized in the Ten Commandments, particularly the moral aspects of it. What's the purpose of the law? To provoke terror in us. It's intentional. It shows us, if this is how I depend on being pleasing to God, I will fail. I cannot meet this demand. And that's what it's supposed to do. It's supposed to make you look forward to a coming Messiah as you work with the priest and give a sacrifice and put your faith in it and the coming Messiah or Savior. And then you become a believer and a follower of God. Because without the benefit of a relationship with God, we should live in terror of God. 2 Corinthians 5:10-11 says, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore," Paul said, "knowing the terror of the Lord." It's translated in our ESV as fear. The word there is phobos, which is terror. Knowing the terror of the Lord, knowing that God must evoke fear correctly and rightly in me. If I stand under his judgment, I should be trembling. I should be reacting like those Israelites. It's just too horrible for us to even listen. It evokes too much fear. That's the right response. If I don't have forgiveness in Christ, I should be trembling. I should be afraid. And what saddens me today, friends, is that there are people who have lost the fear of God. That's why many people do not believe that they should listen to God. They have forgotten that God is a terror. If I defy God, I should be terrified of God. If I think I don't need God, one day I will face him. And I should be trembling before that day comes. That's the terror of the Lord, intentionally designed and part of the law that we might realize our bankruptcy. You see, friends, without a right fear of God and recognition of sin, we would never see the need to seek refuge in the love and forgiveness of God. That's why when you speak about grace, we must first speak about how we stand before God. Because if we speak only of grace and forgiveness and love, but we don't talk about Who is God? God is holy. Who is God? God is perfect. Who is God? God is just. Who is God? God can never tolerate sin. Who is God? God will judge sin. Who is God? Man's good works will never erase his sin. That is God. So what should we do? We should see ourselves like God sees us and then accept the way he has given to you and I to be forgiven, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. We will never see the need to seek refuge in the love and forgiveness of God until we have the terror of God. I want to ask this question before I move on to the next point that we have. Have you ever come to that place in your life that you realize who God really is? His holiness just dawned on you. Our unworthiness just broke into your consciousness. And you can't get rid of it. It plagues you night and day. It haunts you. This God is holy, and I am under his judgment. And he deserves to do anything he wants to do with me, and I deserve to take it. When you've come to that point, and then you say to the Lord Jesus Christ, you said you are the way, the truth, and the life. You said no one comes to the Father except through you. I believe you. I take your words as the absolute truth, and I turn to you for salvation, forgiveness, based on what he did on the cross. And if you say that, if you believe that with all your heart, God will make you one of his. He'll forgive you. And you don't ever need to fear the judgment of God ever again. I'd like that to be very clear, because I know we have quite a sizable online audience. I know that even many of those of you here on site are believers. I'm not going to presume that. If you've never come to that point, if somebody just told you, you just need to love Jesus, that's very doubtful where you are now. I'm sorry to say that. I hope I don't offend you, but if you came to Christ because somebody said, you just need to love Jesus and you'll be fine. That's not how it begins. You begin with the terror of the Lord. God is a terror to those who do not come to him and admit their sin and need of him. Friends, that's Mount Sinai. That's who we are without Christ. In Mount Sinai and the terror of the law. But if you've ever made that decision in your life, I now need to present the other picture. I believe this describes most of you. I pray it describes all of us, including our online worshipers. In verses 22 to 24, this is now who you are in Christ. If you have received him as Savior, you're now in Mount Zion. That's a picture for heaven, a recipient of joyful grace. Look at verse 22. It says, but you have come to Mount Zion. Who is he talking to here? Remember, he's talking to Christians. The book of Hebrews was written to churchgoers in that area where this writer was addressing, probably a group of house churches, a group of growth groups like we have today in our church. And he was telling them, you've not come to Mount Sinai because you're believers. Instead, verse 22, you have come to Mount Zion. What is that? That's a picture of heaven. In other words, he says, I want you to realize the new covenant is where you're living in now. Once you have come to faith in Christ, you're no longer under the old covenant, which rightly provoked terror in your heart. You're now under the new covenant, which now should provoke joy, gratitude, and appreciation of grace. Now, let's look at what happens when you become a believer. What you see in verses 20 to 24 is a listing of future grace. Now, why am I talking about future grace? All of us have already received past grace, right? Most of you, when I say grace, will think about your salvation. That's correct. And what should be a response to past grace? Gratitude. Thank you, Lord. You know what happens when I live in gratitude? I have strength for the present because I will always remember, you know what? The business is really floundering right now. My children are about to go to college, or my marriage is really on the rocks right now, and I'm too ashamed to approach the pastors or elders yet. But I will not give up on life or on this marriage or on my faith because I have received past grace. God has been good in the past. That means He is still good in the present. That's how gratitude for past grace gives you joy for the present. But what the writer is now doing, because by the way, from Hebrews chapter 1 to 11, he's been talking about past grace a lot. I mean, almost all the time, it was past grace. This is what God has done. Christ came. He replaced the Old Testament system. Past grace, past grace. Now, please look at your Bibles. He's now going to talk about future grace. Did you ever ask yourself, I wonder what heaven looks like? I wonder what heaven contains? Are they all there playing harps and having wings and flying around? Lord, help us. If that's heaven, I want to be elsewhere. I don't think that's what we're going to do in heaven. You know, have harps, have little wings, call Lord White, and fly around. I think that's punishment. No, that's not heaven. You want a picture? Look at your text. Look at your Bibles. Here's what he says. It's all good news, friends. And this is just a small number. Just seven of an infinite number of joys in heaven. The first one is this. You have come to the heavenly Jerusalem, the city of the living God. What is he saying? The best part of heaven is God. The best part of heaven is being welcomed by God, not being rejected by God. And I was reflecting on this in connection with the rest of Hebrews, which is, I believe, the right way to do it. Before we open worship around 9 o'clock, we gather here for prayer. It's how Joey Arakama does my sound check. Because I was reading about heaven and the Holy of Holies, they just stuck together in my mind. So when I was praying at 9 o'clock, I sort of lost it. I got very emotional. Because you know what heaven is? Heaven is pictured by the place that a high priest in the old covenant went to once a year, called the Holy of Holies. That's a picture of heaven. The high priest could not go there except once a year. And he had to go through such an elaborate ritual of sacrifices, killing an animal for his own sins and an animal for the people, the Israelites. Then and only then could he be brought before God, and only once a year and only one person. A picture of heaven, the unapproachable. A picture of heaven, the unachievable. And then Christ comes. And then you put your faith in Christ. And what does he do? He tears the veil. And when he has torn the veil, the message is, you are not just permitted here. You are not tolerated here. I want you here. I desire you here. This isn't for high priests only. This is for you. With all your struggles, with all your sins, in all your unworthiness, this is for you. I want you here. That's the message of heaven. That's why the same writer said, let us therefore boldly approach the throne of grace that we might find grace and help in time of need. He could say that because he knew the mind and heart of God, that God wants you there. You're not just permitted. You're not tolerated. You're desired. You're wanted to be before the throne of God. And how do you do that today? When you pray, when you open your Bibles and your personal devotion and you just seek God from a heart that's hungry for Him, you're in front of God. That's what Christ has done for us. That's grace. That's past grace, and it's still ongoing. And in heaven, the same God is waiting for you, the God you can access here and now because of Christ. What else do we see, friends? We see millions of angels in joyful assembly. Wait a minute, Pastor. Where did you get that? It says here, a large assembly. Well, the word here in Greek is 10,000 times 10,000. Are there any math geniuses here? What is 10,000 times 10,000? No answer. Maybe you're like me. You didn't like math. That's why I went into medicine. Anyway, it's 100 million. But it's not supposed to be literal. It's supposed to be an understatement. There are probably more than hundreds of millions of angels, but it's saying here that there are hundreds of millions of angels, look at it, in joyful assembly. You know, sometimes we look at angels as, you know, just waiting there by the throne of God. Okay, Lord, what's the next mission? Are we wrestling with some devils today? Lord, will we help that guy again who keeps repeating the same thing? I don't think so. What are angels doing in heaven? Look at your Bibles. They're in joyful assembly. In fact, the word here is used only once in the entire New Testament. The word used here for joyful assembly was used for the celebratory atmosphere after a yearly athletic competition. Did you see the closing ceremonies of the Olympics? Have you ever watched one? That's the picture here. That's what's happening in heaven. It's not a boring, dry place where we just play harps and float around. You know, I always ask myself, what am I going to do there forever? It's a place of joyful celebration, and the picture is, we don't have any clear idea yet because our minds are too limited about what joy in heaven really means. We have only pictures, shadows, small insights, but it's joyful. That's what you're getting here. It speaks of a big gathering to celebrate an occasion of joy or delight. Jesus referred to it when he said, there is joy in heaven over one sinner who repents. He had the same idea. He was actually referring to this very same joyful assembly. So this occasion is filled with excitement, celebration, well-being. What else? It says it's the church of the firstborn whose names are written in heaven. You know who those are? The firstborn whose names are written in heaven. You know who those are? That's you. Have you ever come to that point of receiving Christ by faith alone? Because you have turned to Him for forgiveness? Then that's you. The word firstborn here, which is normally reserved for Christ, in the Greek is plural. So the church of the many firstborn, that's what it means. And then it says their names are written in heaven. So who is that? New covenant Christians, you. Isn't that wonderful? You mean my name is written in heaven? Yes. What is my name there? I have no idea. It reminds me of the women who say, when I die, you make sure you get a good makeup artist, okay? I want to look very pretty in my coffin. My answer to that is, you don't even know what's going to happen, you know? Oh, look, she's moving or something like that. I mean, wow, in heaven, friends, when we are there, you don't bother about what your name is. The fact is, it is written in heaven. I remember Jesus saying to his disciples in Luke chapter 10, 19, you know, the disciples were rejoicing because they had just been sent out and came back, and they said, We delivered people from demons and did this and this and this. And Jesus said in Luke 10, 20, that's not the main cause of rejoicing. If you can look up your Bibles in Luke 10, 20, he said, rejoice rather that your names are written in heaven. So maybe you can wonder, I wonder what my name there is. Well, you will not know until you're there. But rejoice that it is written in heaven. Number four, God the judge of all people. You know, we do not really, those of us who are preaching here, we don't study the original. to make you distrust the English Bible. Our English Bible is very reliable. It's just that when they translate, for example, from the Greek to the English, they rearrange it sometimes because it's easier to read in English. But the ESV is a good translation. But here in the original, this is what it really says. To a judge, the God of all. The word judge is ahead of God of all. Why? The writer, under God's direction, was trying to emphasize, you're coming to a judge, but not a bad judge. To a judge, the God of all, as if to emphasize, this judge will vindicate you. I don't know what it means exactly, because one commentator said, and I will read it, that the author probably had in mind a strong notion of the vindication of God's righteous people, a prominent theme in the entirety of Scripture. I believe this means that God will be a judge in your favor, not against you. He's there to vindicate you before the wicked who made life hard for you. I was watching a basketball game last week. I'm not naming names, okay? Because it might be your favorite team and you'll not like me. As I was watching the game, it was a good game from the beginning. But you know what? When the second, third, fourth quarter came, the officiating just really went very bad. All the calls were for the team that eventually lost. I mean, every single thing they did, foul. Somebody would shoot, their hands were raised, there was contact, foul. I said, you know, it's going to be a good game if you call it right. Eventually, they lost, that poor team. Bad officiating. You know, you're living in enemy territory now. There's going to be a lot of bad calls against you. This is no longer your home. When you received Christ, you signed up God's kingdom. And you got the second most powerful being in the universe and his entire army of millions of angels against you. So don't expect that life will always be good for you. And please, don't always blame God for every bad thing happening to you. And don't blame God when your boss is like the boss from hell. Don't blame God when you've got a neighbor from hell. Sometimes we get those. But what this is saying, a judge, the God of all people, is this. Whether angels or demons or people, they will be judged. And the judgment will always be in your favor. The referee, the one who never makes mistake, God, will always judge in your favor. Especially when this life has nothing been nothing but a bad deal for you because of people. And I hope this changes your attitude towards those who break your heart. They're going to get judged. And that judgment is permanent. It's irreversible. They're going to pay for it. You know, I have to tell myself this sometimes because the few times I drive, I sometimes really lose my temper. You know, somebody, a Jeep will stop in the middle of the road and you almost ram the person going up, you know. And I say, what in the world is happening here? Or somebody will cut you off because he's rushing somewhere. Or somebody does something to you that you never saw coming. But you know what? Now that you know that there will be a judge, God of all people, can you really hate them? They're going to be judged. Those who are getting away with it now, they're going to be judged. And they're not going to get away with it. They'll pay for it. So maybe, just maybe, instead of hating them, maybe we need to reach out to them. Whether they believe your message or not, whether they say, oh, I accept your Lord, or the Lord Jesus, like you're asking me to or not, it doesn't matter. Let's try to help them because the judgment is going to be irreversible. A judge, the God of all people. Number five, the spirits of the righteous made perfect. These are Old Testament believers. I'll not dwell on this because this is simply to give us joy. But it means that when those believers in the Old Testament died, they were not yet completed in their salvation because they had to wait for Christ. They were looking forward. Remember, the Old Testament saints and Christian believers were looking forward to Christ coming, and only when Christ came was their salvation completed. It was a future one. We are so blessed. The moment you receive Christ, because we're looking backward to a historical event, we're saved completely. Unlike the Old Testament saints. So it says here they've been made perfect because Christ has come. Number six, Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant. Like I told you, friends, the best part of heaven, it's not really the celebration. It will be there. It's not really seeing loved ones who died ahead of you. That will be there. That's joyful. But it's seeing God and realizing He wants you there. Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant. That's Acts 4:12. There is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Finally, the sacrifice that speaks better than the blood of Abel. What is this? Well, friends, when Cain and Abel, remember, the brothers, when Cain murdered Abel, in Genesis 4:10, it says there that the blood of Abel cried out to God for judgment. I don't think that's literal. It's God saying that blood is a testimony against the murderer. That's why there are quite a few preachers, and I cannot say I disagree with them, who are saying if the extrajudicial killings in this nation are never given justice, there's going to be a curse on this nation. Those families have to receive justice. But before I go off track, it says here, the sacrifice that speaks better than the blood of Abel, because the blood of Abel was crying out for vengeance. What is the sacrifice that speaks better? The sacrifice of Christ. It's crying out to people and saying, here's forgiveness. Here is the darkness of sin, but here's forgiveness. God is not waiting over you, seeking to make you fail and fall and then blast you with judgment. Jesus' blood is an offer of forgiveness. It's a sincere one. It's a genuine one. And you can take it when you put your faith in Him. That's why it speaks better than the blood of Abel. I'll close with this, friends. We said that the whole point is that gratitude for past grace and hope in future grace gives joy for the present. You've just looked at future grace. Isn't it wonderful? So wonderful. It reminds me of a passage in John that says, whoever has this hope in Him purifies himself, as Christ Himself is pure. You see, friends, someone not amazed at grace may have never received it. When there's one of us who's saying, you know, God, You could be better to me, huh? You, Lord, do a better job with me. That's a scary attitude. You need to be more fair to me. That's a person who doesn't know grace. I prayed to You and You failed me. We have a word for that the youth are saying a lot. Entitled. When I cannot appreciate grace, it's just one of two things. One, I never really received it. I never began. Because a real Christian is humbled by it, is strengthened in the present by it, is hoping until the future because of it. So either I've never been saved or I'm just really, really ungrateful, entitled, privileged, thinking God owes me everything. When actually it's the opposite, friends. Those whom grace has grasped will never get over it. Those whom grace has grasped will never get over it. It wakes you up in the morning and pulls you out of bed. I look forward to this day because whatever I'm going through, God is there. And at night, whatever you've been through, good or bad, you can sleep well. God, if I wake up tomorrow, it means you'll be there. If I don't wake up in this part of life, I'll be with you. There's no way it's going to be bad for me. That's grace, friends. That's gratitude for grace. That excitement for future grace. The Christian's life cannot be anything but joy. Listen to what Jesus said. John 15:10-11. If you keep my commandments, you'll abide in my love. These things I've spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. And he said in John 16:22, no one will take your joy from you. Why? It's a person. It's the presence of the Holy Spirit. Joy is the emotion of salvation. It's the joy of seeing, knowing, loving, and trusting Jesus Christ. And we cannot manufacture it. It's a product of the Holy Spirit. Last, and I'm done. Last night, I was with Pastor BJ, and we had a very, very heavy meal to celebrate his anniversary with Dr. Bebet Sebastian. And you know what? It was so heavy, I could barely walk. Have you ever stood up from a buffet? Have you? Well, I'm almost sure you have. Now, when you stood up from a buffet to leave, if somebody offered you, would you like a plate more of medium rare steak? You'd probably say, are you serious? I'm already walking out of this buffet. I might die if I eat that. When my heart and your heart is full of joy over grace, it keeps us from the evil one saying to you, I have something to offer you that God will not give you. You can tell Satan or his demons or the world or whoever he uses, I'm not having that. I've had my feast, you know. I've encountered the living God. In church, in my small group, in my quiet time, in my prayer time, I've encountered the living God. I'm full. I'm not taking that. I hope you discover the joy that God wants you to have. If you've lost it, may it return to you, because gratitude for past grace and hope in future grace gives us this joy for the present. Father, as we now enter into our communion, may our hearts be filled with the joy that comes from being so deeply loved, forgiven, redeemed. Sometimes even as believers, we still make horrendous mistakes, embarrassing, humiliating mistakes. And yet, your word to us is, come back to me with all your heart, and I will forgive you and cleanse you and stand you up on your feet again. We thank you, Lord, because that past grace enables us to enjoy and celebrate this communion with gladness. At the same time, Lord, we pray that this communion we're about to partake reminds us of our accountability also, out of the joy of our lives, to get rid of sin and anything that breaks your heart. Friends, I'm going to give you a minute of personal silent prayer. I just want you to examine whatever in your heart, in your life, the past few days. If there's anything there that you know God is not pleased with, will you settle it with Him? Because we want everybody to join us in communion. But until you've done that, I hope you're not comfortable taking the elements. You can settle it right now. Will you do that, please? Will you take a minute for personal silent prayer and keep account with God? And Father, we are so grateful that there's no one in this assembly right now who wants to make things right more than you. Thank you for every person who prayed and said, Lord, this will end now. Oh Lord, I confess this to you. Take it out of my life and let's do this together to never go this way again. Father, if possible, may everyone joining us who has received Christ, online or on site, please let them join us here. Because this is a celebration. And may they not exclude themselves because they refuse to give up something that you're telling them to give up. We praise you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. May I please request you to prepare yourselves to join us in the communion. If you're online, you may also take a piece of bread and some liquid, hopefully fruit juice, to remind us that Christ's blood and body were given for us. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And then he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." You may take down your mask temporarily and take of the elements of the bread that reminds us of the body of Christ. And after Jesus had distributed the bread to his disciples, that same night, he would take some fruit of the vine and tell his disciples that this cup is the New Testament in my blood, a new covenant. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Let us remember the blood of Christ as we partake of this. Please put back your, in the pockets beside you, the used elements so that our ushers can gather them easily. I'll be praying, and then our choir will continue to bless us with singing. And I hope you can join us. It's very, very wonderful to join them. Let's pray. Lord, just as our choir sang, may your grace always amaze us. May it give us the strength to go on, especially during the difficult times. But when times are not that hard or difficult, may that same grace make us grateful so that life is not really something to tolerate, Lord, something to put up with until we are in heaven, but something to be enjoyed because you are real. And this joy is not manufactured. It's not fake. It's as real as you are. And may this be the experience of every believer here with us who believes in grace and is grateful for it and continues to trust and hope in a future that they will experience more of it. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We thank you, Father, that the song reminded us what we just did. The communion reminds us everything was finished on the cross. So, Lord, we will leave this place today honoring you for what you've done for us. And, Father, we just pray that you enable us to live lives that are filled with joy because we're grateful for what you've done and we look forward with excitement to what you have prepared for us. Bless your people as they go. May they represent you, Lord, with their joy wherever they are. That's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. You go with God.
You've just heard a message from the Word with Green Hills Christian Fellowship, Ortigas, in partnership with Far East Broadcasting Company, Philippines. We hope you can join us next week. God bless you.